Okay. Well, first of all, let me thank Lisa and Bernadette for the great work they did. They are very organized and excellent, really. So again, thanks to the Water Forum and to you two in particular. We're talking about precipitation, and we're going to talk about satellites. This is my main research interest, and I'll be happy to answer any question today or in the next days, months. My office is in the engineering building. If you have any suggestion or doubt, or if you're interested in working on this topic, please let me know. I'll be happy to answer any questions you might have. How much did it rain yesterday, and how sure are we of that answer? Well, obviously, if we can answer the first question, but we cannot answer the second question, well, then the first answer is not that useful to us. If we know that yesterday it rained, and actually the day before yesterday it rained a lot, let's say that it rained 10 millimeters per day, but the uncertainty related to that measurement is, let's say, 200%, then is that 10 millimeters per cent really useful to us? That's the main question I'm trying to answer here. This is challenging, and it's very challenging because precipitation is a bad guy. Precipitation is not a continuous process, it's intermittent. So it only occurs in storms. And between two storms, obviously, there are periods of zero rain. The other thing is that, if you know anything about statistics, unfortunately, precipitation doesn't follow the nice, normal bell curve shape. And this is because most of the precipitation events are really tiny. Okay? Large events, large intensity, large size events are much more rare. Okay? So again, we have much more tiny and light events than larger ones. This is also very important. Why? Well, as you probably know, precipitation is the major driving force of the hydrological cycle. So we really know, really need to know how good we can measure precipitation if we want to use that observation for any kind of hydrological applications. If you think about any decision that we have to make that is relative to hydrologic processes, then we need to know that uncertainty associated with precipitation measurements. Can we measure precipitation globally? And if we can, how? Question for you. How can we measure precipitation globally? If you know the title of my talk, it's pretty easy. Satellites, okay? We can measure it from space. This movie won the Oscar, so I suggest watching it. It's a good one. From space. Well, this is just, I don't think this is complete, but these are the satellites that are now orbiting and watching the Earth. We really need to implement what we have now out there and think ahead for future missions if we want to determine the global hydrological cycle, okay? And again, precipitation is a major component of it. So we really need to look at precipitation measurements from satellites if we want to better characterize the hydrological cycle, okay? Well, unfortunately, satellites are not perfect, okay? Thanks to me, so that I have something to work on, but and actually, this is an art installation in Berlin. This is by an artist. So it was actually there. The picture is not that great, but it was actually there, I think, in the year of 2000. But this is to tell you that satellites are affected by errors due to many different things, due to sampling errors, due to the kind of terrain that we're looking at. Obviously, if we have a complex topography, then it's much harder for our satellite to see what how much rainfall it gets the ground. When we talk about precipitation satellite precipitation products, I have to tell you that in the past decades, they have improved a lot. There are many studies out there talking about and trying to improve precipitation measurements from satellites. But the analysis of the errors that are associated with those satellite precipitation measurements are not, they didn't receive much attention in the past. So this is where I really want to focus. The idea is really to quantify the uncertainty associated with satellite measurements. So again, going back to the very beginning, if a satellite tells me that it rained 10 millimeters per day in Washington, D.C. on March 20th, I want to know, is it really 10 millimeters per day, or is it 10 millimeters per day plus minus 2? Okay, I want to attach those errors to the estimates from the satellites. And this is very important for a few applications. I'm going to list here a few of them. Obviously, if you think about climate analysis, climate analysis, precipitation is, again, one of the major components. So errors associated with precipitation measurements are fundamental. Agricultural planning, obviously, we need water for irrigating fields. Water resources management, and hazard mitigation. So when we talk about floods and droughts, again, precipitation is the guide. So that's what we need to look at. This is a picture from Catania in Sicily, Italy, from I think last year, if I'm not mistaken. This is another example to explain again how important this project is. There is this model, which is called the Global Flood Monitoring System, which is developed by a scientist at the University of Maryland. It's a model that gets as an input the rainfall, and then it gives us an output of runoff. So that's just to monitor floods, and it works all over the globe. Okay? Do you remember the Colorado flood in September? Last September was a big one. Well, that model didn't capture the flood. Major event, he didn't see it. Why? Not because the model was incorrect, but because the input was incorrect. The input from the satellite was one third of the actual precipitation that was observed at the ground. So again, the model wasn't wrong, but if the input is wrong, we're not gonna get a good output. Hopefully, I convinced you that errors are important and precipitation is too. So what we want to develop here is really a framework, a practical framework that estimates errors for high-resolution satellite precipitation products at a global scale. So satellites are global. We also want to give an error estimate that is global. Obviously, we will develop a framework, and then we need to test it with good validation data. But the first thing to do is really to define the error, okay? What is the error? The way we decided to define it is the difference between satellite observations, and that is my X, and some reference, okay? The good data I was talking about is our true, so it's our reference data, which when we talk about precipitation, it's usually gauges at the ground. There are other reference data sets that we could look at, but in this study, I decided to take the ground measurements as my truth. Okay? Now, satellite observations, well, that's given, okay? This is what the satellite is observing. So it's given at any time step, at any location. Why the reference data? Well, we have reference data, we have ground observations over the US, for example. But if we go to Kenya, Africa, do we have ground observations? No. OK? Okay, so that's what I need to estimate. That's what my model, my framework, will be estimating, that y. If we have x and we estimate y, then we can compute the other. Okay, again, as a difference between the two. It can also be the ratio, whatever you want. My model will give you y, and then from there you can compute your errors. Feel free to stop me at any time if you have any questions or something is not clear. I'd be happy to help you. Now I'm going a little bit into the details here, and I'll talk about statistics. Hopefully you have some background on that. But the approach that our model takes is what we decided to define as a divide and conquer approach. Why is that? Because we really want to model four different cases. Let me drive you through those cases. When we see a satellite estimate, the satellite estimate can be either zero, no rainfall, or higher than zero. You see a DH there is a threshold, which is very close to zero, so you can really see that threshold as a zero rainfall. Okay? If the satellite is measuring no rainfall, then the reference might agree on that. In that case, we have the correct no rain detection. Okay? Zero, zero. However, the satellite might also miss that event. In that case, reference is zero, but my truth is saying rainfall. Then we have a missed event. The numbers that you see down there are probabilities. So the correct no rain detection over Oklahoma, which as I will say in a few minutes, is my region of interest. Okay, that's where I focus in order to come up with a framework. Over Oklahoma and along my time period, which goes from 1998 until 2011, is 85%. It's not that bad, okay? It means that 85% of the times that the satellite is measuring a zero, it's correct, okay? But 15% of the times, it misses, right? Okay? So the idea for the model is to come up with an estimate y hat 0, which is the estimate of the reference rainfall, of the true rainfall, in the case when the satellite is measuring this. Let's go to the second case, which is the more complex one. Now, the satellite is seeing some rainfall, okay? Well, the reference might say, well, it didn't rain. In that case, it was a false alarm. Okay, the satellite is giving us a false alarm. It's saying rainfall when it didn't rain. But it might be correct and hit. So both ground reference and satellite are saying rainfall. Well, but they might say a different number. One might say 5, the other one might say 10. So we still have an error there. What you see here in those two plots are probabilities. The first one here is the probability of false alarms. As you see in the plot, it depends on the satellite rainfall. If you think about it, if the satellite rainfall is small, so if the satellite is saying 0.5, 0.2 millimeters per day, then the probability that that is a false alarm is high. But if the satellite is giving us an estimate of 30 millimeters per day, then the probability that that is a false alarm is very low. Okay? The heat probability works exactly the opposite. So this is just 1 minus the probability of false alarms. Okay? Now, starting from that divide and conquer approach, we came up with a framework, which we call PUSH, Precipitation Uncertainty for Satellite Hydrology Model. And this is exactly this. Schematics here just describes what I have talked about for the contingency table in the previous slide. So again, we start from the satellite observation, we check whether it is higher or lower than the threshold of the zero, and then we have the four different cases. The idea is to come up with an estimate, the white hat, of, careful here, is the probability distribution of the correct rate. Okay? It's a PDF. And the PDF will be different if the satellite observation is lower than zero, and it will be something else if the satellite is higher than the threshold. But again, the model output will be a probability distribution. And I'm going through the two cases, and this might be a little clearer. Case zero, satellites are saying that there was no precipitation. Then again, we have the correct, no rain detection. In this case, if you think about it, how much is the error? If it is correctly detecting no precipitation? Zero. But that's not true. It's not true just because we are a higher threshold. Okay, so if you think about it, it's actually somewhere between zero and the threshold itself. So we decide to model that as a uniform distribution between zero and the threshold. Okay, but you're totally right. Ideally, it would be zero if the threshold were zero too. Okay? And then we have the second case, the missed rainfall. In this case, I picked the gamma distribution. Don't worry too much about it. I picked the gamma distribution to describe the missed rainfall. Let's go to the plot here. The first one, the uniform distribution, is the blue line here. Again, just a uniform distribution between 0 and 0.1, which is the threshold. The gamma distribution here, the missed events, is the red line there. Now, what I do for my model is to combine those two, and this is a very simple weighted average, where the weights are given by the probability that each case happens. So again, those 85% and 15% that I mentioned before. Now, if I combine those two lines, blue and red, by weighting for, by using the probabilities, then what I obtain is that gray histogram in the plot, which if you look at it, it's somewhere in between the two lines, okay? That gray line, that gray histogram is the output of my model for cases when the satellite says no rain, okay? That's a probability distribution. It's an empirical probability distribution because it's a combination of something else. But again, this is the output of the model for those cases. And now let's look at the other case when the satellite says rainfall. Now we have, do you remember, the false alarms and the heat cases? Well, again, here I picked some distribution, the normal distribution for the false alarms and the heat, and the gamma distribution for the heat. And I combine, again, the two by using the probability of false alarms. It works exactly the same way. Blue line is the normal distribution, that's the false alarm cases. The red line is the heat. I combine the two by weighting using the probability for each case, and I obtain that gray histogram, which is again the output of my model now for case one. Okay? Who is gonna use this? We thought that there might be some regular user who will be interested in having just a single estimate of the error. So they will want me to give them just a single value, as I said before, plus minus 2 millimeters per day. That's it. In that case, since the output of my model is a probability distribution, I might give them either the median or the mean of that distribution. Again, one single value. But we might have some superheroes out there who are interested in the actual distribution of the error. In that case, we can just provide them with percentiles, quantiles. Okay, it can be the 25th, 50th, and 75th percentiles, but it can't really be anything. Okay? Some data. As I mentioned before, we need to test our model. Now we developed the model, we know what we want from our model, but we need some data to test it. So we picked a reference. Again, it's called the CPC Unified Gauge Analysis. It's produced by NOAA. And that's a map of Oklahoma and the mean precipitation that is measured by that gauge analysis. So these are ground observations. This is the truth. Okay? And then we have the satellite, which is a NASA satellite. I'm giving you some information about it. So as you see here, we are looking at pixels. Okay? Satellite data are pixels. Okay? We have information that are spatially distributed. And in this case, we are looking at a 25-kilometer spatial scale daily data. Okay? And again, the time series is between 1998 and 2012. Just a few info about the true data set. So these are daily data, again, at 25-kilometer grid, which corresponds exactly to the satellite resolution. It's available for a long time series, since 1948. And they use about 8,000 daily gauges for what they call the real-time analysis. But they have additional gauges to make a total of 1,200 stations when they do the reanalysis. So from 1948 to 2006, they have 1,200 gauges. And then from 2007 to the present, they are only using 8,000 gauges, but still a lot of gauges. That's the idea. What's a satellite data set? It comes from TRIM observations. TRIM is a NASA satellite that you see orbiting down there. It's a combination of radar and passive microwave together with some infrared information from geostationary satellites. TRIM was launched in 1998 and it's still providing us with information. And it has a coverage that is near global, between 50 north and 50 south. Calibration. I'm not going through these plots, but the idea is that we need to calibrate the model. Okay? And we decided to calibrate it over Oklahoma by using the time series that goes from 1998 to 2011. We kept 2012 for validation purposes. I did some analysis to see whether the calibration was depending on the season, so if we had to use different parameters for summers versus winters, that wasn't the case. If you look at the correlation coefficient, for example, in the first plot here, the correlation is about 0.7 for all the cases. So there is no seasonal dependence, at least over Oklahoma. I did some cross-validation, which means that basically you take out one year and then you calibrate based on the remaining data set, and you do it for each year. And again, what you see is that the correlation is about 0.70 something. So again, there was no particular year that was giving us problems. And then I looked at how many years do we need for our calibration purposes. Again, if you look at the scale here, it's about 0.74 in each case. So if we use more than 5 years, we still have similar results. And now I want to convince you of how good the model is. So I picked, now, to prove this, I picked a period that was included in the calibration period. That's the dependent period from 2004 to 2006, 3-year period, which is done for basically verification purposes. And then we have an independent period, 2012, for our validation. The gray histogram here is the observed, so that's a true, it happened, that's how the distribution is. And the black line is my model for both cases. As you see, first of all, the shape of that histogram or that distribution is well captured by the model. And the intensity has been captured as well. So we were happy of seeing, you know, these results for this case zero. And now for case one, things are a little more complicated. Now I have to do it for different satellite precipitation values. For the previous case, satellite precipitation was zero, or between 0 and 0.1. But here I have different values of precipitation, so going from 2.5 up to 20 millimeters per day. And what you see here is, again, the dependent period, the independent period, and the gray histogram being the observations, and the black line being my estimate. Again, things are working fine. I just want you to know that peak in the distribution, that's a false alarm peak. Do you remember that normal distribution, that blue line? That's the false alarms. And if you notice, we have a high peak for satellite precipitations equal to 2.5 millimeters per day, but when we go to the 20 millimeters per day, that peak doesn't exist anymore. And again, that's why, that's because the probability of having a false alarm for high rainfall rate is much smaller than for lower values. The plots on the right are normalized differences. This was the between the observed and estimated. This was done to see whether there was a systematic bias that was introduced by the model. But as you see here, they are either negative or positive, but not systematically. So it means that the model is not is not adding any bias to our results. This plot is telling you that for each value that the satellite is giving us, we can really give a value of the error. The background here is a density scatter plot, and those are observations, whereas the line on top of those are estimates from the model. The black line, the black solid line here, is the mean. The dashed line is the median, and the other two gray lines are the 25th and the 75th percentiles. If you look at the mean values, they are really lying on top of the most populated areas of those density plots, which is good, okay? It's good because it means that the mean is a good estimate. So our regular user will be happy to have the mean as an estimate of the error. On the other hand, if you look at the percentiles, 25th and 75th, they really bounce most of the points, okay? So this is also an indication that the PDF of the error is working fine. And to convince you further, these are QQ plots. Do you know what QQ plots are? No. QQ plots are quantile versus quantiles plots. So here I have the estimated quantiles versus the observed quantiles, done for the 25th, 50th, which is the median, 75th, and the mean, okay? And the black line is the one-to-one line. So if the points are close enough to the one-to-one line, then it means that our estimates are good estimates, okay? And this is for 2012, for the independent year. I can assure you that these are good QQ plots. So again, as you see, the cloud of points is really valid. Around the one-to-one line. And the correlation coefficient probably is very high. Maps. This is the 4th of July 2005. You have the references. So these are gauge observations. You have the satellite observations. And you have the estimated reference. This is the mean estimated by the model. Observed error is just the difference between the reference and the satellite. And then the estimated error is the difference between the satellite and the estimated reference. So basically what we are comparing are these two maps, okay? The observed error versus the estimated error, okay? Again, estimated by our model. And then here you have a scatter plot of the estimated errors versus the observed mass. It's okay, it's good. Both the spatial pattern of the error is well reproduced, and if you look at the scatter plot, I think that scatter plot has a correlation coefficient of 0.85. It's not perfect, but it's not perfect because this model is supposed to be good statistically. Okay, so it will be perfect if we look at those distributions. If we compute the distributions, then yes. But if we look at the specific case, at a specific time, at a specific location, then you know it might be wrong. In this case, for example, we are a little overestimating the low end of that distribution. And I have another case for the 4th of February 2012. In this case, we are underestimating some errors at the high end. But again, spatial pattern is there, and intensities are also close enough. Just a few things that I want you to remember. This push framework is assigning an error at any time step and any location. Which means that even if the satellite, so the estimate from the satellite is zero, the framework will be assigned a value. This is very different from traditional multiplicative error models. Obviously, if you have a multiplicative error model, it means that it will give you something to multiply by the satellite estimate. If the satellite estimate is zero, then your error, final error, will be also zero. Which obviously is not correct, because we also have those mixed events, which is about 50% of the time. So it's an important component that we need to take into account. Another thing is that most of the traditional rainfall error models are not taking into consideration the false alarms, whereas our model does. And here I have an example, it's still same maps from 4th February 2012. Look at this case. The satellite is measuring something there, but the ground was a zero. There was nothing. Well, our estimated error is giving some values there. And in fact, the observed error had some value there too. Okay? So again, this is something that is different from what people have used so far. The last thing I'm talking about, and this is very brief, scientists might be interested in the decomposition of the error between systematic, which is what we call bias, and the random. And there is a method which is a very neat and simple method, actually, to do that. So the method, which was developed back in 1981, just decomposes the mean square error as systematic component plus a random. Very easy. So what are we going to do? Well, this is the plan. We estimate that y, so the distribution of the rainfall, of the true rainfall using push. And then we compute the error as the difference between the mean of that distribution, for example, and the satellite estimate. Then the systematic component will be MSC, so the mean square error systematic component divided by the total mean square error. And the random component would be 1 minus that. How do we estimate those components? Well, we use historical data. I did that, and this is what I obtained for Oklahoma. Okay, this is still the same map I showed you before. This is Oklahoma. Well, most of it is random, as you see in the plot, about 100%. Why? Well, Oklahoma is easy. Over Oklahoma, we have a lot of gauges, which means that the bias from the satellite would be very small. Okay? And there is no topography. It's flat and nice. Okay? That's why I like to work over Oklahoma. But things might be a little more complicated than that. And if we look at the US, for example, then it's different. If you look at the West Coast down there, then the random component is smaller compared to the systematic, which means that we have biases that are playing some role here. Conclusions, what I want you to remember from today. Well, we came up with a model that estimates errors associated with satellite precipitation problems. The output from the model is really an estimate of a global. I'm saying global, and I only showed results over Oklahoma. We are expanding. Okay, so we tested the model over Oklahoma. It works. We are happy. Now we need to expand it. We need to expand it first with the US and then going to other lands over the globe, and then also include oceans, which is another huge problem there because we don't have ground observation over the ocean. What we saw was that PUSH was able to reproduce the probability distribution of the reference rainfall, both in shape and magnitude. And if you remember those maps, also the spatial pattern of the error was pretty well captured. We also look at a way of decompose that error into a systematic and random component. But there are many, many things that we still need to do. We want to use different satellite estimates. The one I show you was just a NASA trim estimate, but there are so many other products out there that we want to look at. One is CMOR, which is the NOAA product. And the other one is the GPM iMerge product, which will come out in the end of this, by the end of this year. I don't know if you know about GPM, but this is the Global Precipitation Measurement. It's NASA, JAXA, which is the Japanese Spatial Agency mission. It was launched last February. So if you go to the NASA website, or probably on YouTube too, you can find some videos of the launch, which was pretty cool. From Japan, that's where they launched it from. We want to look at higher temporal resolution. So here again, we focused on daily estimates, but 3-hourly is one of the goals. And if you think about GPM iMerge, that new product will be available at 1/2-hourly. So we might need even finer resolution there. As I've already mentioned, we need to expand it to other regions. And this is fundamental if you think about engaged regions of the world, where really any kind of water resources management program, hydrologic application, they only rely on satellite estimates. That's the only available precipitation measurement data. And I guess that will this. I will thank you very much for being here today and take